Thank you. Brand new series. Our series is entitled Demonology, or What the Bible Says About Demons. We're going to spend quite a bit of time in our discussion on demons. We're going to study the biblical teaching on demons in 13 major areas. So this will be a somewhat lengthy series. And the first area concerning demons is some words of introductory. And I want to say two things by way of introduction. First of all, where does the word demon come from which we get the theological term demonology or the doctrine of demons? The English word demon comes from the Greek word daimonia, D-A-I-M-O-N-I-A, and daimonia is used a total of 60 times in the New Testament. 41 of these times it is in the plural, 8 times it is in the plural, and 19 times it is in the singular. And demonology can be called the doctrine of demons or the doctrine of fallen angels. A second thing by way of introduction is to mention some wrong views about demons. At this point we shall only mention these wrong views. We shall deal with the reasons why they're wrong as we go through our study on what the Bible says about demons. But for now, it's sufficient if we note 6 wrong views. The first wrong view is that demons simply do not exist. That, of course, is the view of many naturalists and many skeptics of the Bible. And basically, the unbeliever does not hold to the existence of demons. A second wrong view concerning demons is that demons are not personalities. Rather, they are evil emanations without personalities. They are just influences. They're emanations. They are powers, but they're not personal beings. A third wrong view is that they are responsible for every sin. This is a wrong view that even Christians sometimes hold, and they believe that every time they commit a sin, it's due to a demon or due to Satan, and hence we have that common expression, the devil made me do it. Well, sometimes the devil may have made you do it. In the majority of cases, you did it, not the devil. And the third wrong view is to make demons or Satan responsible for every sin. A fourth wrong view is the view that teaches that they are responsible for every form of physical infirmity. Every time you have some type of physical infirmity, that is the responsibility of demons. Now, some physical infirmities are caused by demons, but as we shall see, not all. A fifth wrong view is that demons are responsible for every form of mental infirmity. And again, demons are responsible for some mental infirmity, but not responsible for all of it. And the sixth wrong view is that they are responsible for every form of spiritual infirmity. And again, they are responsible for some, but they're not responsible for every form of spiritual infirmity. These are the 6 wrong views that people hold concerning demons. And what the truth is will be developed as we proceed through our study. The second major part of our study then concerns the topic of the existence of demons. Does the Bible really teach that demons exist? And the answer is yes, the Bible does teach that demons do exist. And we find the positive teaching about the existence of demons in 3 main ways. Number 1, the existence of demons is mentioned by every New Testament writer except the author of Hebrews. Now, I did not say that they are found in every book of the New Testament. They're not. But they are mentioned by every New Testament writer, since some writers wrote more than one book. Every single New Testament writer mentions the existence of demons except one, and that is the author of Hebrews. But at least he does mention Satan, who was the head of demons. For example, in Matthew, demons are mentioned in chapter 4, verse 24, chapter 8, verses 16, 28, 31, and 33, chapter 9, verses 32, 33, and 34, chapter 11, verse 18, chapter 12, verses 22 and 24, chapter 15, verse 22, and chapter 17, verse 18. Mark mentions demons in chapter 1, verses 32 and 34, in chapter 3, verses 15 and 22, chapter 6, verse 13, chapter 7, verses 26 and 30, chapter 9, verse 38, and chapter 16, verse 9. Luke wrote two books of the New Testament, and he mentions demons in both those books. He mentions it in his first book, the Gospel of Luke, in chapter 4, verse 33, in chapter 7, verse 33, in chapter 8, verses 2, 27, 35, 36, and 38, in chapter 9, verses 1 and 49, and in chapter 11, verse 15. Luke also mentioned demons in his second book, the Book of Acts, in Acts chapter 5, verse 16, chapter 8, verse 7, chapter 16, verses 16 through 18, and chapter 19, verses 12 through 16. The author John, who wrote a total of 5 of the New Testament books, mentions demons in 3 of these 5 books. He mentions demons, first of all, in the Gospel of John, in John chapter 8, verses 48, 49, and 52, and in chapter 10, verses 20 and 21. He also mentions demons in his first epistle of John, in 1 John chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. He also mentions demons in his last book, the Book of Revelation, in chapter 8, verses 10 and 11, in chapter 9, verses 1 through 21, in chapter 12, verses 7 and 9, in chapter 16, verses 13 and 14, and in chapter 18, verse 2. Another New Testament writer was the Apostle Paul, who wrote the majority of the books in the New Testament, and in 3 of these books he mentions demons. He mentions them in 1 Corinthians 10, verses 20 to 21, in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, and 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. Another New Testament writer is James. He mentions demons in James chapter 2, verse 19, and chapter 3, verse 15. Another writer is Peter, who mentioned demons in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4. And then we have Jude, who mentions demons in Jude, verse 6. So every writer of the New Testament mentions demons somewhere in his writings, with one exception, and that is the unknown author of the book of Hebrews, and at least he mentioned Satan. If he believed in Satan, he obviously also believed in the existence of demons. So every New Testament writer, with one exception, taught the existence of demons. A second way to show that the Bible teaches the existence of demons is the fact that demons were recognized as existing by Jesus. And he recognized the existence of demons in 2 ways. Number 1, he positively taught that demons really do exist. We find him teaching this in Matthew chapter 7, verse 22, in chapter 10, verse 8, in chapter 12, verses 27 and 28, and chapter 25, verse 41. Jesus also taught about the existence of demons in the Gospel of Mark in chapter 7, verse 29, and chapter 16, verse 17. We find Jesus also mentioning demons in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10, verse 20, chapter 11, verses 18 through 20, and chapter 13, verse 52. So first of all, Jesus clearly recognized the existence of demons by teaching that demons do exist. A second way that Jesus clearly recognized the existence of demons is that he was in the task of casting demons out. And of course, Jesus would not go around casting something out that did not exist to begin with. The very fact that Jesus cast out demons shows, by his actions, that he taught the existence of demons. We find him casting out demons in Matthew 12, 22-29, in Mark chapter 1, verse 39, in chapter 5, verses 1-20, then in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4, verses 35 and 41, chapter 8, verses 29-33, Luke chapter 9, verse 12, and chapter 11, verse 14. Clearly, Jesus recognized the existence of demons, both by his teachings and by his actions in casting them out. And of course, there's one more way, a third way, which we can see that the Bible clearly teaches the existence of demons, in that the existence of demons was recognized by his disciples, both within the apostolic group and outside of the apostolic group. Within the apostolic group, we find the disciples recognizing the existence of demons in Matthew chapter 10, verse 1. And then outside the apostolic group, we find demons recognized by the 70 disciples in Luke chapter 10, verse 17. There is no question then from these three categories that the Bible clearly teaches the existence of demons. Now we move on to the third major part of our study, which has to do with the names of demons. Demons have various names given in Scripture, and we will look at this in two categories. First, Old Testament names, and secondly, New Testament names. Among the Old Testament names, there are a total of 12 Old Testament names concerning demons. First, they are called the angels of evil in Psalm 78, verse 49, because that's what they are. The word angel means messenger, and these are messengers of Satan, who is described as the evil one. Secondly, they are called the sons of God. In the Old Testament, whenever you see that expression, the sons of God, it always refers to angels. Sometimes refers to good angels, but also refers to evil angels or demons. One place we see the term the sons of God used in relationship to fallen angels or demons is in Genesis 6, verses 1 and 4. A third Old Testament name is the name Shedim, S-H-E-D-I-M. Shedim is a Hebrew word that means to rule or to be Lord. It is used of demons in Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 17, and Psalm 106, verse 37. This emphasizes a demon's desire to be Lord or to rule over a person by means of indwelling him from the inside or even controlling him and his activities from the outside. The fourth Old Testament name is Se'irim, S-E-I-R-I-M. Se'irim refer to demons that have the form of a goat. As we shall see, demons do have animal-like features, and some demons have the form of a goat, and those demons that have the form of a goat or that have goat-like features are known as Se'irim. So it's no accident, for example, that the Church of Satan has for its symbol the head of the goat. And the term Se'irim is used of demons in the Hebrew text of Leviticus 17, verse 7, 2 Chronicles 11, verse 15, Isaiah chapter 13, verse 21, and Isaiah chapter 34, verse 14. The fifth name is the name Lilith, L-I-L-I-T-H. Lilith is a Hebrew word that refers to a night demon, the demons of the night. It is used of demons in Isaiah chapter 34, verse 14. By the way, some of these names you won't find in English text because sometimes they simply translate the meaning of the name rather than transliterate the name itself. So I'm giving you the name as it appears in the original Hebrew text, though the English may be a translation rather than a transliteration. A sixth Old Testament name for a demon is the term evil spirit. emphasizing what a demon is by nature. A demon is a spirit being, but it is an evil spirit being, a spirit being that is fallen. And the term evil spirit is found in 1 Samuel 16, verses 14 through 16, and verses 23 through 24. Again, in 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 10, and chapter 19, verse 9. A seventh Old Testament name is the name Lying Spirit. This characterizes what demons often do. They are liars. They're characterized by falsehood. And we find this name in 1 Kings 22, verses 21 and 22. The eighth Old Testament name is a familiar spirit. This is used of demons that are involved with witches and spiritualists and things of that nature. And those demons that reveal themselves through these mediums and wizards and witches, these are referred to as familiar spirits because they are familiar with the history of the individual that they pretend to be the spirit of. And you'll find them mentioned in Deuteronomy 18, verse 11, Isaiah chapter 8, verse 19, and chapter 19, verse 3. A ninth Old Testament name is the name God, G-A-D, God, which means fortune. This is the demon of fortune mentioned in Isaiah 65, verse 11. A tenth name is Meni, M-E-N-I, which means fate. It is the demon of fate, mentioned also in Isaiah 65, verse 11. An eleventh name is the name Elilim, E-L-I-L-I-M. Elilim is often translated into the English as merely idols, but actually refers to demons of idolatry. Behind idolatry is the work of demons, and those demons especially involved in the work of idolatry are entitled as the Elilim, and they're mentioned in Psalm 96, verse 5. The 12th and last Old Testament name is the name Ketev, K-E-T-E-V. This is a Hebrew name that means destruction, and it emphasizes those demons involved in the work of destruction. That name is found in the Hebrew text of Psalm 91, verse 6. So these are the 12 Old Testament names. Now the second category concerning the names of demons is the names of demons in the New Testament, and there are four major names. The first is the name that somehow contains the root for demon. The root for demon. Now, the root meaning of the word demon is the word intelligence, because demons are intelligent beings, and the root word for demon is used a total of 79 times in the New Testament. And of this basic root for demon, there are a total of 6 different forms. The first form is the form daimon, D-A-I-M-O-N, which means evil power, and that form is used in Matthew chapter 8, verse 31. The second form, which has the root demon in it, is the form daimonion, D-A-I-M-O-N-I-O-N. This is the most basic word for demon, used a total of 63 times. The first one, daimon, is used only once. This one, daimonion, is used 63 times. And one example is Luke 4, verse 33. A third form, which has the root word demon in it, is the word daimoniodes, D-A-I-M-O-N-I-O-D-E-S. And daimoniodes means demonical. Demonical. It is used only once, and that's in James 3:15. A fourth form of the word that has the root for demon in it is the word daimonizomai, spelled D-A-I-M-O-N-I-Z-O-M-A-I. And daimonizomai means to be controlled by a demon from within. To be controlled by a demon. It is used a total of 13 times, and one example is Matthew 4, verse 24. The fifth form of the root demon is the word deisidaimonesteros, and deisidaimonesteros is spelled deisidaimonesteros, which means to be very reverent to demons. Very reverent to demons. It emphasizes the occult world. It is used only once in Acts 17, verse 22. And the sixth and final form of the name demon with the root word demon in it is deisdaimonios. And deisdaimonios is spelled deisdaimonios. And deisdaimonios means demon worship. It too is strongly connected with the occult world. It's used only once in Acts 25, verse 19. A second major name that refers to demons is the use of the word spirit. The word spirit is used in conjunction with demons a total of 46 times and in 5 different categories. First category is that of an evil spirit. And examples here are Luke 7:21 and Acts 19, verses 12 through 16. A second form of the word spirit is an unclean spirit, and demons are called unclean spirits in Matthew chapter 10, verse 1, and chapter 12, verse 43, then in Mark chapter 1, verse 27, chapter 3, verse 11, chapter 5, verse 13, in Acts chapter 5, verse 16 and 8, verse 7, and Revelation 16, verse 13. A third way spirit is used in connection with demons is the term wicked spirits, and one example here is Luke 11, verse 26. A fourth category is to call them seducing spirits, and that is found in 1 Timothy 4, verse 1. And fifthly, you have spirit and demon used together, where they're called spirits of demons, in Revelation chapter 16, verse 13. Now, a third name for demons is angels. Demons are referred to as angels because they also are messengers, which is what the word angel means. In the case of demons, they are called the devil's angels, in Matthew 25, verse 41, and Satan's angels, in Revelation 12, verses 7 through 9. The fourth and final New Testament name for demon is the word destruction, and destruction is the name of the demon of the abyss, according to Revelation 9, verse 11. His Hebrew name is Abaddon, A-B-A-D-D-O-N, but his Greek name is Apollyon, A-P-O-L-L-O-M-O-N. Whether you use the Greek or the Hebrew, the meaning is the same. His name is destruction. So these are the Old and New Testament names for demons. Now the fourth part of our study has to do with the personality of angels, or rather demons. After all, are demons mere emanations or influences or powers? Or does the Bible teach that demons have real personalities? There are three attributes of a personality. If you can prove that something has all three attributes, then you have proven that that something is a personality, and the three attributes are intellect, emotion, and will. And do demons have these three things? Well, let's see what the Bible says. First of all, intellect. Do demons have intellect? And the answer is yes, and we see that in six ways. Number one, demons know who Jesus is, according to Mark 1:24. Secondly, demons know their own future doom, according to Matthew 8, verses 28 and 29. Thirdly, demons know both Jesus and Paul, according to Acts 16:16 and chapter 19, verse 15. Fourthly, demons know that God is one, in James 2:19. Fifthly, demons have a counterfeit system of doctrine, according to 1 Timothy 4, verses 1, 2, and 3. And sixthly, demons have the ability to communicate with speech, which also shows intellect, in Luke 4, verses 34, 35, and 41, and chapter 8, verses 28 through 31. Very clearly, then, demons do have intellect. They do have the first attribute of personality. Now, secondly, do demons have emotion? Do they have emotion? And the demons have emotion, we see, in two ways. Number one, they have the emotion of fierceness and anger in Matthew 8, verse 28. And secondly, they have the emotion of fear in Matthew 8, verse 29 and James 2, 19. So demons have the second attribute, that of emotion. The third attribute of personality is the attribute of will. Do demons have a will? And again, the answer is yes, as we can see in three ways. Number one, they have the ability to make a request, as they do in Matthew 8:31 and Luke 8:32. Secondly, they have the ability to obey commands and orders, as we see in Mark 1, verse 27, and Luke chapter 4, verses 35 and 36. Thirdly, they have the ability to leave a person, to look for a new place to live, or to return to the old place they used to live, as we see one demon doing in Matthew 12, verses 43 through 45. All of these are evidences for the exercise of will. So demons do have all three attributes of personality. They have intellect, emotion, and will, and that shows that demons have personality. There's one other way that we can prove the personality of demons, and that is the fact that when the New Testament speaks of demons, it uses the personal pronoun. It never says that they are an it, which is what would be natural if they are mere emanations. But in dealing with demons, it uses the pronouns we, us, they, your, I, and me, as we see by way of example in Mark 5, verses 6 through 13, and Luke 8, verses 28 through 30. So these personal pronouns, in addition to the attributes of intellect, emotion, and will, all of these clearly show that demons are real personalities. Now that brings us to the fifth main division of our study, and the fifth main division of our study concerns the origin of demons. Where did demons originate from? What is the order of demons, or the origin of demons? In discussing the origin of demons, we need to separate demons into two categories. The two categories are free demons and confined demons. I should point out that ultimately, all demons, both the free and confined, have the same origin. They fell with Satan at the time of his fall. But since then, some demons, all demons originally were free demons, but then some of these have been confined demons, and we need to draw that distinction. So first of all, let's discuss free demons. What is the origin of free demons? To understand the origin of free demons, we must remember that demons and fallen angels are one and the same. Demons and fallen angels are one and the same. These are not two categories of beings. Fallen angels and demons are one and the same, and we see this in five different ways. Number one, both demons and fallen angels are said to have a similar relationship to Satan. For example, in Matthew 12, verse 24, Satan, who is an angel, is called the prince of demons, and that indicates that those who follow him are also angels. Secondly, in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 11 and 12, we read how Satan has a well-organized order or rank of angels, and it is very reasonable to suppose that these fallen ranks of angels are demons. Thirdly, in Matthew 25, verse 41, the devil's angels are in all likelihood demons. And the same thing is true in the fourth passage in Revelation 12, verses 7 through 9. So these four passages show that angels, fallen angels, and demons have a similar relationship to Satan, implying that they are one and the same. The second evidence that fallen angels and demons are one and the same is that they have a similar essence of being. Both are spirit beings. They share the same essence. Thirdly, demons and fallen angels have similar activities, in that, first of all, both seek to enter men, and secondly, both war against men and God. That fallen angels do this, we see in Revelation chapter 9, verses 1, 2, 11, 13, 14, and 15. And the fact that demons do the same thing is brought out in Revelation 9, verses 3 through 10, and 16 through 21, again indicating that angels and demons are the same. The fourth way of seeing that fallen angels and demons are one and the same is that they both share the same abode, and the abode of demons and fallen angels is the air. They dwell in the atmospheric heavens, and this is brought out by Ephesians 2 verse 2, Ephesians 6 verse 12, and Revelation 7 verses 7 through 12. The fifth evidence that demons and fallen angels are one and the same is that in all biblical texts, we either find fallen angels or demons. We never find them both. We don't find one verse mentioning fallen angels and demons. Every passage that speaks of either one or the other, but never both the same at the same time. And the fact that every biblical text, we either find fallen angels or demons, but never both at the same time, clearly indicates that they are one and the same. So, in order to discuss and understand the origin of free demons, we should remember that free demons and fallen angels are one and the same. And once we understand that, then we can clearly understand what the origin of free demons are, in that free demons being fallen angels, they originate at the time of the fall of Satan, in that demons are the angels that fell with Satan at the time of his fall. It's Ezekiel 28 verses 11 through 16 that speaks about the fall of Satan. And we are told in Revelation 28, verse 16, that Satan fell by the abundance of his traffic. And what the Hebrew terminology implies is that Satan went from one angel to another angel in order to capture the angel's allegiance to himself. And these angels, some of these angels, were deceived by the satanic lie that is given in Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 through 14, the satanic lie that he will accomplish those five I wills, including the desire to be like God. Now, some angels were convinced by Satan's claim, though the majority were not. But those angels that were convinced by Satan in his trafficking, as he went from one angel to another, defaming God and capturing the angel's allegiance to himself, those that were convinced are the ones who fell with Satan, and they are now the demons which are free and doing the bidding of Satan. The result of the fall of these angels is threefold. Number one, they lost their original holiness. Secondly, they became corrupt in nature and conduct, as the various Old Testament and New Testament names for demons show. And thirdly, at that point, the angels became the demons of Satan. That is the origin of free demons. Ultimately, all demons have the same origin in that all demons originated with those angels that fell with Satan, but some of these have since been confined. Now, we already talked about the origin of the free demons, then what about the confined demons? And here again we have to make a distinction, because there are two different categories of confined demons. One category of confined demons are the temporarily confined demons. Some demons are confined temporarily. Some demons are confined temporarily after being cast out of a person, as is the case of Luke 8:31, where the legion of demons did not wish to be sent into the place of confinement and asked to be allowed to go into the pigs. So some temporarily confined demons, as those in Luke 8:31, are confined temporarily after being cast out and then are released. Many others are confined there temporarily to be released for specific judgments of the Great Tribulation. So quite a few demons are confined right now, but they'll be released in the Great Tribulation. Revelation chapter 9 verses 1 through 11 speaks of the release of demons for a period of 5 months to torment men to a great degree but short of death. Then Revelation chapter 9 verses 13 through 21 speaks of the release of 200 million demons for the purpose of killing one-third of the world's population. Now, the place where temporarily confined demons are confined is the abyss. That is where they are temporarily confined. They are confined in the abyss. So, in dealing with temporarily confined demons, they are confined in the abyss. Some are confined there now to be released in the Great Tribulation. Others are confined there after being cast out, confined temporarily, and then released again. But there's a second category of confined demons, and these are permanently confined demons. Demons that have now been confined, and they have been confined permanently, not to be released, but will move directly into the lake of fire. And there are three main passages that deal with these permanently confined demons. The first passage is Genesis chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. Now, I realize that this is a major area of debate among believers, whether this refers to angels or not, but I hope to show that it really does refer to angels that are now permanently confined. But in order to prove my case, we're going to study these verses phrase by phrase in somewhat detail. So let's look at Genesis chapter 6 verses 1 through 4. Now verse 1 speaks of the multiplication of humanity, and it says, "It came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the ground, and daughters were born unto them." Verse 1 emphasizes the multiplication of humanity. The multiplication of humanity. The Hebrew word for men here is a word that is generic. It refers to humanity in general, including male and female. The first place that the word men is used, "It came to pass when men began to multiply." The Hebrew word here is a generic term. It is humanity in general. It includes male and female. And the word as such cannot be limited to the sons of Cain. And it includes both Sethites and Cainites. I might point out that both Sethites and Cainites died in the flood. Another key word that is found in verse 1 is the word daughters. That is the Hebrew word that means females. The emphasis in the second part of verse 1, where it says daughters were born unto them, emphasizes the female portion of humanity. Again, the expression cannot be limited to the female descendants of Seth, as some teach. It simply is a word that means the female portion of the population. So verse 1 can read, man, M-A-N, humanity, man or humanity multiplied, and daughters were born unto them. The distinction in verse 1 is not between male Sethites and female Cainites, as some teach. Rather, the emphasis is on the female portion of humanity in general, which would include both Cainites and Sethites. The next verse is verse 2, which describes an intermarriage that is unique, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were fair or beautiful. They took them wives of all that they chose. Verse 2 describes an intermarriage, and here we need to break this verse down very carefully to see what it is saying. The first key phrase here is the term sons of God. The term son of God is a general term that means to be brought into existence by God's creative act. And because the term sons of God means to be brought into existence by God's creative act, it is used very selectively. Throughout the Old Testament, the term sons of God is used always of angels. And this becomes very clear if we compare the same usage in other parts of the Old Testament. It is used in Job chapter 1, verse 6, Job chapter 2, verse 1, and Job 38, verse 7. Now, mind you, no one debates that in the other places the word sons of God is found in the Old Testament, it clearly refers to angels. They want to make chapter 6 of Genesis the one exception, and there is simply no warrant for making any exceptions here. In New Testament, the sons of God term is expanded. Adam is called the son of God in Luke 3:38 because he was brought into existence by creation. And believers are called the sons of God in John 1:12 because we are considered a new creation according to the teachings of the New Testament. But here we're dealing with a specific Hebrew expression, benei, B-E-N-E-I, Elohim, E-L-O-H-I-M, as it's used in the Hebrew Old Testament, and that is a term that is always used of angels. The distinction in this passage, then, is not between Sethites and Cainites, but between humanity and angels. The word men here emphasizes humanity. The term sons of God emphasizes angelanity. The second key expression in verse 2 is the expression daughters of men. An expression daughters of men is a generic term for women, which includes females of both Sethites and Cainites. And what the verse is saying is, the sons of God saw the daughters of men. There is no justification for this verse to be interpreted to mean godly males intermarried with ungodly females. Rather, the daughters of men simply means womankind. The sons of God refers to angels. If we let the passage speak simply as it says, if we keep the meanings consistent both in the Hebrew text and its usage elsewhere in the Old Testament, the passage is clearly speaking of fallen angels intermarrying with human women. And we see this in two ways. Number one, it is always a one-way intermarriage. Notice it always says sons of God marrying daughters of men. There is no record of daughters of God marrying sons of men. Now, if the distinction was between Sethites and Canaanites, it simply would not happen this way, because in society you have intermarriage both ways, and we see this nowadays. Sometimes Christian males marry unsaved females, and sometimes saved females marry unsaved males. But here we have only a one-way intermarriage, the sons of God intermarrying with the daughters of men. If the other claim was true, it would mean that male Canaanites married female Sethites, but male Sethites never married female Canaanites, which is highly unlikely. Intermarriage would thus be confined to godly men with ungodly women, but not godly women with ungodly men, and yet the text itself limits this relationship to a one-way intermarriage. We might ask the question, if these were really godly Sethites, why are they marrying ungodly Canaanites? If they were really godly men that it's talking about here, if these are really godly men, how come they're marrying ungodly women? So number one, it is a one-way intermarriage, which simply would not be true if only dealing with differences between believers and unbelievers. But secondly, the context clearly speaks of a cohabitation that is unusual and unnatural and causes the worldwide flood. Verses 1 through 4 speaks of the angelic cause of the worldwide flood, while verses 5 and 6 speaks of the human cause of a worldwide flood. But the context speaks of a cohabitation that is unusual and unnatural and results in the flood. We have discussed the origin of free demons. We've discussed the origin of temporarily confined demons. And now we've been discussing the origin of the permanently confined demons. So we've been dealing with an exposition of Genesis chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. And we left off discussing verse 2, where we pointed out that what verse 2 clearly is teaching is an intermarriage, not between godly Sethites and ungodly Canaanites. We are dealing with an intermarriage that is unnatural, that causes the flood. And what we have here is intermarriage between fallen angels and human woman. Now, those who do not like this teaching object to it by quoting Matthew 22, verse 30, and they say that Matthew chapter 22, verse 30 clearly teaches that angels are sexless. Now, is that really what Matthew 22, verse 30 is really teaching? Let's look at Matthew 22, verse 30, and see what it really says and what it does not say. In Matthew 22, verse 30, Jesus says, "For in the resurrection they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are as the angels in heaven." Now, what Jesus is saying is that human beings at the resurrection, human beings in heaven, do not marry or give in marriage. And notice that the angels he's speaking about in verse 30 are angels in heaven. It says they're like the angels in heaven. It doesn't say they're like the angels, period. But rather, they become like the angels in heaven. And the emphasis is that in heaven, good angels neither marry or are given in marriage. But Genesis chapter 6 is speaking of fallen angels on earth. Also notice that Matthew 22 verse 30 makes the same point about human beings. Now humans in heaven do not marry or give in marriage. What about humans here on earth? Do humans on earth marry and give in marriage? Well, they certainly do. So here is a contrast between what's happening in heaven as over against what happens here on earth. So in heaven, angels do not marry or give in marriage, and we humans in heaven will not marry or give in marriage, but the situation we're discussing here is not what's going on in heaven, but what is going on earth. Now, angels are never said to be sexless. In fact, always the male gender is seen. Now, angels, it is true, do not procreate after their kind, meaning angels do not give birth to other angels as such. But angels are always described in the masculine gender, not in the feminine gender, nor are they ever described in the neuter. They are always in the masculine gender in both the Old and New Testaments. And whenever angels become visible, they never become visible looking as young women. They always appear as young men. Every time someone saw an angel, it always looked to that one as being a young man. This we see, for example, in Genesis 18, verse 1, through chapter 19, verse 22, Mark 16, verses 5 through 7, Luke 24, verses 4 through 7, and Acts 1, verses 10 and 11. So Matthew 28, verse 30 cannot be used as an argument against the angelic interpretation of Genesis 6, verses 1 through 4. Because we are dealing with a situation on earth, not in heaven, and Matthew 28:30 does not teach that angels are sexless as such. Now the question is, well, if this was an intermarriage between fallen angels that fell with Satan and human woman, why did Satan do this? Why bother? Well, the reason for it can be understood if we look at the greater context of Genesis. Three chapters earlier, back in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, we had the first messianic prophecy. And the first messianic prophecy declared that the Messiah would be born of the seed of the woman, who in this seed of the woman will crush the head of Satan. So what we have happening in Genesis 6 verses 1 through 4 is a satanic attempt to corrupt the seed of the woman by having some of his angels take on human form. And angels, when they take on human form, always appear as young males and intermarry with humankind. The events of Genesis 6, 1 through 4 was a satanic attempt to cancel out the prophecy of Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. That is the reason for the intermarriage. The result of this intermarriage is the judgment of God given in verse 3. And Jehovah said, "My spirit shall not strive with man forever, for that he is also his flesh, yet shall his days be 120 years. In verse 3, God pronounces the judgment, and the judgment is the Holy Spirit will not continue to strive with this kind of evil forever, and God has decreed the destruction of humanity to occur 120 years after his statement in chapter 6, verse 3. Then in verse 4, we are given the product of the union between the sons of God and daughters of men. The Nephilim were in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same were the mighty men that were of old, the men of renown. To break this verse down to get a clearer concept of what it is saying, we need to first of all discuss that first name called the Nephilim. In some translations, the word Nephilim has been translated by the word giant, and people reading it pictured these huge human beings. But the Greek word Nephilim does not mean giants. It simply means fallen ones. The word does not mean giants in the sense of huge beings, but a race of fallen ones. The reason it was translated giant is very interesting. In the Greek translation of the Old Testament done about 250 BC, when the Jewish scholars translated verse 4 into Greek, they used the word gigantes, G-I-G-E-N-T-E-S, and the Greek word gigantes is the Greek word that meant titan, T-I-T-A-M. Our English word giant comes from this Greek word gigantes. But what were the titans in Greek mythology? The titans in Greek mythology were part men and part god. In Greek mythology, the titans were part men and part god. And when the Jewish scholars in 250 BC translated the word Nephilim to Greek, they used the Greek word for titans because they recognized this to be a union not of two types of human beings, but of angels and human, producing a being that was neither angel nor human. And so at least the Jewish scholars of 250 BC that lived so much closer to the time that Moses originally wrote this passage clearly understood this to be an intermarriage of fallen angels and human women. So as a result of this union, you had a new race of beings called the Nephilim, a race of fallen ones, and they were gigantes. They were superhuman, but not in size, but they had human characteristics, but were at the same time superhuman. And they had extra capacities, both mentally and physically, though they might not have been any bigger than normal human beings. It is in Genesis 6, verses 1 through 4, that we see the source of the legends of Greek and Roman mythologies, where you had these gods from Mount Olympus intermarrying with human beings on earth and producing children that had superhuman characteristics, who were greater than men but less than God. The book of Genesis tells us what really happened, the true history of what happened. What we have in Greek and Roman mythology is the corrupted account. In Greek and Roman mythology, what happened is elevated as something special. And this is the human perspective in mythology. In Greek and Roman mythology, the intermarriage is elevated, but God in Genesis called it sin. So again, in Genesis, we have what really happened. In Greek and Roman mythology, we have the corrupted account. The second word we need to note in this verse is the word Giborim, G-I-B-O-R-I-M, which is translated as the mighty men, the men of renown. Again, because this was a product of fallen angels and human women, they were unique. They were the Giborim. Notice there is no mention of mighty women, which would be strange if this was a normal union. After all, a normal union, you have both males and females produced, and if this was a natural union and the product of a natural union, you should have mighty men and mighty women. You don't have that. You have only mighty men, because what you have is a new race of beings that is neither human nor angels. And these are the Giborim, and the only way of explaining the origin of the Giborim is that they are the origin of this union, which is the point of verse 4. Only if we accept the angelic explanation of chapter 6 does other areas of biblical teaching make sense. It provides the only adequate explanation for certain statements of 2 Peter and Jude that we will be studying next time. It is a peculiar sin. It is connected by Peter and Jude in connection with the flood, and it is different than the original fall of angels, otherwise all would be permanently confined. But we'll see what Peter and Jude have to say about this on Monday. Until then, we bid you shalom.